morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Well, she's done as much cowboy work as any of us. Her dad was a legend among the working cowboy brotherhood, Tom Dynnesson, better known as Rock Creek. And her young life so far would make a great book. Today, I'll visit with Leanne Dynesson.
I was all about riding colts and riding the rank ones and that, but that wore off for me. I broke my back a couple times. And
on the Rangeland News, you'll hear from U.S. President Joe Biden and Agriculture Secretary Tom Vilsack on an issue that's really important to cattle producers.
And I think you're going to see competitive pricing, and that's going to benefit farmers, and it could very well benefit consumers as well.
And in the cowboy poetry spotlight,
you don't know how to ride. Heck, you can barely drive a Jeep. This whole idea is dumber than 100 head of sheep.
Yeah, one from the late and much loved Jess Howard. And we'll dig up another story from the vault.
Last thing I remembered seeing was that barn hallway rooftop. You know, I mean, as he hung my head on it when he run into the barn screaming and bucking.
On the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, a lot about winter riding on the Northern Range. And my old pal, R.W. Hampton, just keeps putting out great songs like this one.
I went north on the Chisholm Trail in 1868. We left Fort Worth on the 15th day of May. We crossed Red River Station with 2,000 head of steers, heading north to Kansas, working for our pay. At night we counted stars beneath the Oklahoma sky and dreamed of fame and fortune on the way. By the time we camped at Round Pond, we were mighty tired and sore, and Abilene seemed half a world away. Long days in the saddle, sleeping on the ground, where I tossed my bedroll, that is where I lay. Not that I'm complaining, 'cause I've got a job to do, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm a cowboy now, a cowboy I will stay. I went north on the Western Trail in 1881. We were bound for Dodge City on the rail. We forded the Red River at Doan's Crossing, headed north with 3,000 head of cattle on the trail. Dusk we watched the Nighthawks as they danced in lonesome flight, and we listened to the coyotes as they sang. We drifted off to dreaming that we'd always be this young in a land so wild and free out on the range. Long days in the saddle, asleeping on the ground, where I toss my bedroll, that is where I'll lay. Not that I'm complaining, 'cause I've got a job to do, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm a cowboy now, a cowboy I will stay. I've loaded Curly's cattle on a truck that's headed north. He waves goodbye and sends me on my way. This old job, it hadn't changed much since 100 years ago, for a cowboy a-riding for his pay. At night I'll count the stars beneath my Oklahoma sky and dream of fame and fortune someday. By the time I get to Pond Creek, I'll be mighty tired and sore, but my troubles will be half a world away. Long days in the saddle, a-sleeping on the ground. Where I toss my bedroll, that is where I lay. Not that I'm complaining, 'cause I've got a job to do, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm a cowboy now, a cowboy I will stay. When my best days are all past me, and my skill is long since gone, and my bones don't move and bend like younger days, I'll travel in my memory to the days that I did ride. I'm a cowboy now, a cowboy I will stay. Long days in the saddle, a-sleeping on the ground. Where I toss my bedroll, that is where I'll lay. Not that I'm complaining, 'cause I've got a job to do, and I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm a cowboy now, a cowboy I will stay. I'm a cowboy now, and a cowboy I will stay.
Leanne Dynesson still lives on the world-famous Douglas Lake Ranch, where she's been for a lot of her life.
So tell me a little bit about your early memories of growing up there.
Oh, I was just always very thankful to have the childhood I had. My dad was Tom Dynesson, but most people knew him as Rock or Rock Creek. He was a cowboy that came to Douglas Lake, I think, in 79 or something like that, from Rock Creek, so very original his nickname.
Oh, so that's, I wondered where the nickname came from.
So. Yeah, he came from the little itty-bitty town of Rock Creek, just close to the border there, east of Osuyas, and so that's where he grew up, and then he did a bunch of logging and a couple other different things, and then he decided that he wanted to go be a cowboy, so he headed to Douglas Lake, and that's definitely what he became.
Man, I'll bet the stories about him could probably make a pretty good book.
They sure could. He was quite a iconic figure. He was definitely unique, and very honored that he was my daddy-o, as I called him. And then my mom was Sharon McRae at the time. She was from Douglas Lake Reserve, and she was a cow camp cook up at Douglas Lake. So she cooked at like Dry Farm, Raspberry, Courtney, kind of the south end mostly. And then she did do quite a bit of cooking at the Home Ranch Cookhouse, and then went to Quishana Hotel for a while, and then back to the north end of Douglas Lake at Chaperon. And
now, can you remember being around the cookhouse when, you know, the crew would be coming in for meals? And...
Yeah, I sure do. I don't remember right off the bat, because my mom actually raised me in cow camp, and so she was cooking for the cowboys and had this little girl with her, and so the cowboys have lots of stories of me and cow camp with them, but I don't remember too much then. But when my brother was born, he was a bit he was premature and a bit on the sickly side, so my mom couldn't be in cow camp raising both, because back then they still had wood cook stoves and had to pack water, and it was just too much. So that's when she moved down to the home ranch to work at the cookhouse.
More from Leanne's amazing story. And we'll tip the hat to another great singer-songwriter who just left us, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Another longtime singer, songwriter, and he was kind of an icon in the world of Texas cowboy music, left us recently, and we'll play one of his songs after Leanne Dynesson has more memories of growing up immersed in the world of ranches, horses, cattle, and cowboys.
Yes, it was a really neat environment to grow up in because we get off school, run to the cookhouse, go visit mom, have a snack, and just sitting around with the farmers and the cowboys, the irrigators, and the truck drivers and that. It was just, it was really cool. We were always the kids hanging around, and we got to hear all kinds of stories, and it just was an incredible place to grow up.
Where did you go to school?
My brother and I both went to school in Merritt, Central Elementary, right from grade one on, and I stayed in Merritt, but my brother went a couple years up to the school right at the home ranch there. That school was pretty cool to go to because they'd get to take field trips out to the brandings and the calving barn and do that sort of thing, so that's a pretty neat field trip for kids in school.
Boy, isn't that a great experience for them to see calves being born and being pulled and that kind of thing.
As I got to share in that, just with going to work with my dad and stuff, and my dad was at Douglas Lake for 17 years, I think, and then he went up to the gang and was the cow boss there for 5 or 6 years. I can't quite remember how long, but my brother and I got to go visit him on long weekends and summer vacation, and it just all sorts of amazing memories and people we got to meet because of that.
Oh, well, there's so many people that, you know, when your dad's name comes up, that they say, oh, I remember him, or I've got a story about him or something. Did you, did you get to ride with him some?
Yeah, I definitely did. Not too much at Douglas Lake because I was pretty young, but he definitely would take us out like on the horse with the sled behind and drag us around and do that sort of thing. And then when he was at the gang ranch, my parents had divorced when I was a few years old, so that's why my dad went to gang and my mom stayed at Douglas Lake. And up at the gang, definitely my brother and I rode quite a bit when we'd go visit him. Me more so than my brother because he was more interested in machinery and that sort of thing, whereas I wanted to be a cowboy.
Well, there's more from Leanne in a few minutes, and I just got the news recently that another legendary Western musician rode across the Great Divide. Back in about 1994, I think it was, we were visiting with the great singer-songwriter Ed Stabler, and he gave us a few of Gil Prather's cassettes. And one of the songs on there was inspired by Ed's wife, Mary. Gil, at that point, was getting depressed and said he was ready to hang up his old guitar. And Mary said, and if you knew Mary, you could imagine her saying this, you'll do no such thing. You'll go home to Texas and write me a nice cowboy song. And he did, and this is it.
I'm on my way to Colorado, trailing dogies up from Mexico. These dogies have a new home in the Rockies. I'll be back in by the fall. I'll spend springtime in the Rockies, beneath blue Colorado skies. The Rio Grande is calling. Time's nice
in Colorado, but winds blow cold. I'll be back in Texas by the fall. I'll spend springtime in the Rockies while on new range the dogs roam. The
Marshalls and Shuttleworths present the 41st Annual Select Charley Bull Sale, March 4th at the Innisfail Auction Market at 1 o'clock. 130 Charley Bulls, yearlings and two-year-olds, horned, polled, whites, tans, and red factor. High-performance, top-quality bulls. View videos of the bulls in the catalog online at dvauctions.com or futurefarms.ca. Give Daryl or Alan a call. Hope to see you at the Charley Bull Sale, March 4th at Innisfail.
Well, Rock Creek, they call the legendary cowboy Tom Dynnesson, and his daughter Leanne is with us today.
So definitely rode everywhere with Dad and at the cabin barn. And then when I was 13, my brother would have been about 10, we spent the whole summer with Dad pretty much in the backcountry of the gang. We stayed at Hungry Cow Camp and with the cowboys there, and we rode with the guys most days, but when it got to be a bit much, we'd just stay in camp by ourselves with no power, no running water, nothing.
Oh, Hungry Valley, that's pretty remote.
That is, yeah, and then one of my greatest memories I'll ever have is we got to go on a two-week pack trip to the Back Mountains with my dad and another cowboy, Kurt Brown.
Oh, for
and my brother.
Yeah, I know Kurt. Yeah,
so there was just the two of them and these two kids, and we each had led a pack horse and had the horse we rode, and because then they used to bring salt in from the Lillooet side as far as they could, and then they'd use a quad and trailer to bring it in the rest of the way, but to spread it out to the cattle, you had to use a pack horse. So we spent 2 weeks out there in the different camps, Lost and Relay, and we rode by Graveyard. We didn't stay there. But it was just absolutely incredible to see that country before it got logged out, and just to spend that time with my dad and Kurt, and It was just absolutely incredible. We didn't want it to end, but our 2 weeks was up and we headed back to camp. And we came down to the home ranch a few times and went to, there was a Ray Hunt clinic that summer we got to go in and that sort of thing. So it was just a real cool childhood, that's for sure.
Oh, gosh. Terry Milliken wrote an epic poem about when Ray Hunt came to the gang ranch. And it is just so funny.
I haven't had
have
the
you ever
chance
seen
to
it?
Read it.
Oh,
no,
gosh.
I'll have to check it out. Cause
he just put a little book of poems together, and it's just kind of like a loose leaf thing. The poems in there are just hilarious.
Okay,
I don't know
cool.
if I can, but I'll try and get you a copy or scan a copy of it or something.
That'd be cool.
Well, there's more from Leanne in a little while, and next, Kirk Brummett with another story from the vault when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
And you'll hear about Kirk Brummett when he tried to imitate Roy Rogers right after this. If you are looking for the kind of bulls that'll make you smile when their calves arrive, be sure and be at Belvin Angus Farm's 10th Annual Bull Sale at the farm south of Innisfail, Alberta, March the 1st. 100 yearlings and long yearling bulls and 10 open heifers sired by these great bulls, known for outstanding EPDs. The sale starts at 1:30, and get this, a complimentary prime rib dinner before the sale. And you can bid online at dlms.ca and see belvinangus.com.
But all of that, the hero sits with Roy Rogers, and how he jumped off a balcony onto the horse. I tried that one morning out of the barn loft onto an old horse Dad had called Spooks, which the name fit him pretty good. Pretty near killed me and the old man. Dad rode that horse up to the barn. I was up in the barn loft, dinking around, pretending to be Roy Rogers, getting in barroom brawls and stuff like that. Dad rode that old horse up to the barn, and my dad ground broke horses. Whenever you dropped reins on a horse, that horse stood there till he starved to death. He just wasn't on track. Well, he rode up to the barn, stepped off of him right there in the barn hallway, dropped reins, went inside the barn hallway. And I looked down and seen that old colt, and I thought, you know, I can do that. I just turned around and jumped off of that barn loft and onto the back of that horse and scared this old horse to death. Last thing I remembered seeing was that barn hallway rooftop. You know, I mean, as he hung my head on it when he run into the barn screaming and bucking. I woke up there on the couch with ice on my head. I had one eye swelled completely shut and the other one just almost shut. And I looked over there and dear old mama sewing up a cut on Dad's cheek. And I heard him tell her, said, Marianne, I don't know what happened. All I know is, as I stepped out of that saddle room into the barn hallway and I got mowed down by a screaming, bellowing gray freight train. The only thing I can figure is that kid walked up behind him, scared the horse. Horse kicked the kid and run over me. That I got trying to get out of his way coming out and some of a buck run over me again. And I never told him no different.
Announcing Horse Expo Canada, the largest equine trade show in Western Canada at Westerner Park, Red Deer, Alberta, April 15th to 17th, 2022. There'll be a trainer's showdown as three outstanding horsemen will start three promising colts, Cade Mills, Jason Irwin, and Trevor Mertis. Great opportunities to learn from Western Horsemen's winner of their Women of the West Award and many more awards, Barbara Schulte, and a chance to learn about mounted shooting and much more from Kane Kwan. Stay tuned, we'll tell you more about who's going to be there in the coming weeks. For tickets and information, see horseexpo.ca or call 1-833-425-1799. And on the Rangeland News, we'll tell you about more outstanding horsemen that have been added to that list. Danny and Susan Gibson are Really a talented father and daughter team, and I love this song that Danny wrote.
I'm always wearing a cowboy hat. Without it, I just don't feel right. It's the first thing I put on every morning. It's the last thing I take off at night. When John B. invented the first Edson hat, I wonder if he could have guessed that with beaver hair and steam and his own hands he created the greatest thing to top off the West. And I'm always wearing a cowboy hat. Without it, I just don't feel right. It's the first thing I put on every morning, it's the last thing I take off at night. The cowboy hat's a symbol of respect for your neighbor, your country and your maker, of course. And a big old hat is sure to make a cowboy look much better and as western as a saddle and a horse. And I'm always wearing a cowboy hat. Without it, I just don't feel right. It's the first thing I put on every morning. It's the last thing I take off at night. Across the Great Divide, I sometimes get to thinking about that. They're gonna have to bury me sitting up, 'cause we wouldn't wanna crumple up my hat. And I'm always wearing a cowboy hat. Without it, I just don't feel right. It's the first thing I put on every morning. It's the last thing I take off at night.
It's the last thing I'll be taking off tonight.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says the concentration of meat packing plant ownership has been a cause of concern for cattlemen in Canada and the U.S. for some time. Well, it looks like, finally, the U.S. government has recognized the problem, and Gary Crawford has the story.
This year began with these words from President Biden.
Capitalism without competition isn't capitalism. It's exploitation.
And since that White House meeting on meatpacking industry competition, there have been developments. And this week, Agriculture Secretary Tom Vilsack was asked by reporters, what results in this arena can we expect by the end of this year? He said first, he's very close to announcing the projects that will get $150 million to improve, expand, or build new meat processing facilities.
And the hope would be that those projects are, in a sense, shovel-ready.
So construction could begin and on some possibly finish by the end of the year. This summer, another bigger round of grants and loans will be announced for the same kind of thing. Also, on another front this week, USDA and the Justice Department launched an online portal for farmers to report unfair or illegal market treatment. Vilsack says all of this may send a message to the market, possibly changing how it treats producers.
And I think you're going to see competitive pricing, and that's going to benefit farmers, and it could very well benefit consumers as well.
This is Gary Crawford reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
And that segues nicely into this story. Tyson Foods shares climbed more than 11% to an all-time high after the company reported the first quarter profits nearly doubled due to soaring meat prices. Shares rebounded from a one-month low, to reach a record $99.20. That's up 14% since the start of the year. And the surge reflects strong demand and high prices for Tyson's beef, pork, chicken, as well as U.S. labor shortages having limited production. And increased prices and profits threaten to amplify Washington's scrutiny of the U.S. meatpacking industry. As you just heard, the Biden administration has criticized a lack of competition in the sector. And Tyson and three other industry giants process about 85% of grain-fed cattle carved into steaks for consumers. And if you're waiting for that new pickup, Ford Motor Company plans to suspend or cut production at 8 of its facilities in the U.S., Canada, and Mexico because of chip supply constraints. The changes come a day after the Detroit automaker warned that a chip shortage would lead to a decline to vehicle volume in the current quarter. Production at factories in Michigan, Chicago, and Mexico will be suspended in Kansas City. Production of the F-150 trucks will be idled, while one shift will run for production of transit vans. My pickup, I don't think, even has a chip. It's that old. Well, you know, farms and ranches usually have a well-equipped shop where equipment, machinery, and anything else can be maintained and repaired as necessary. But the right to repair legislation has seen the dealers maintain a stranglehold that makes it impossible for American ranchers and farmers to fix their own stuff. But now, farm equipment manufacturers would be required to provide all diagnostic equipment to farmers, and the Federal Trade Commission would have the authority to go after the companies that don't under a bill introduced in the U.S. Senate. And the right to repair increasingly is become an issue in agriculture and other industries, with state legislatures introducing bills in at least 32 states. Well, a couple more top trainers have been added to the lineup for Horse Expo Canada. Subjects like retraining your horse off the track by Roy Sturgeon and prepping your horses for futurities and maintaining a finished horse by Vanessa Salisbury. And, of course, it all takes place at Red Deer's Westerner Park, April 15th to 17th. And I am looking forward to doing the commentary on the Trainers Showdown with Cade Mills, Jason Irwin, and Trevor Mertes. And you can get all the information at horseexpo.ca. And bull sale season's well underway. We'll be bringing you news about some of the ones you won't want to miss. Belvin Angus Farm's 10th annual bull sale is going to be held at the farm south of Innisfail on March the 1st with 100 yearling and long yearling bulls and 10 open heifers, and it starts at 1:30. And, they've got a complimentary prime rib dinner before the sale. You can bid online at dlms.ca and see belvinangus.com. And it's Future Farms 41st Annual Select Charlet Bull Sale. That's March 5th at the Innisfail Auction Market. I think they start at 1 o'clock, and you can see the details at futurefarms.ca. And the next regular cattle sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op, February 22nd, and on the 24th in Williams Lake, and a regular cattle sale the 25th of February at the Vanderhoof Yards. Get all the information, and of course you can see the sale streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, regular cattle sales, of course, every Wednesday, lots of special sales coming up, including the Select Charlet Bull Sale on March the 4th. The information and to book your cattle, just give Danny, Mark, or Dwayne a call. 1-800-710-3166. All right, you're ready for the final item now. It seems that a lonely frog phoned the psychic hotline and asked what his future holds. Well, his personal psychic advisor tells him, you are going to meet a beautiful young girl who will want to know everything about you. Well, the frog is thrilled. This is great. Will I meet her at a party? He croaks. And no, says the psychic. It will be in her biology class. Okay, and that's the Rangeland News. Coming right up in the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, a look at how you and your horse can handle riding in the winter when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The Irvin Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File is coming right up, along with more from Leanne Dynesson. But first, way up north, to Alaska, way up north, to Alaska, north, to Alaska, I come north, the rush is on. Here's an updated version on our Spirit of the West farewell cruise. After 19 years of hosting the finest people you could ever meet in some of the most amazing places you could ever be, Billy and I will be stepping back after this one, and we really want to make it two things, simple, uncomplicated, and the best experience you can have. Ah, we love Alaska and all it has to offer. Cruising the spectacular Inside Passage, touring Juneau Historic Skagway, and the amazing Red Dog Saloon, and trying to get the guys to come back out of there. The White Pass Rail Tour on the Trail of the Gold Rush. Lots of live Western music, stories, cowboy poetry, sing-alongs, and so much more. And we'll kick it all off with a special show with the amazing Western Spirit Band right here at the McLennan Ranch. And then we take you to spectacular Sun Peaks, where we spend the night, then down to the ocean for a night in a spectacular waterfront hotel before boarding the luxurious and brand new Holland America Koningsdam. Now this is important. If you would like to join us, please reserve your spot as soon as possible by calling 1-800-530-0131. Sure hope you can come along and share in the good time.
The coho and the spring, the humpback and the dog salmon run. Wonder Fuca's galleon sailed the Puget Sound when the cedar fires of the Salish were the only lights around. And the great Douglas fir at Cathedral Grove were already 500 years old. Take me through the Inside Passage, let the Narrows lead the way. Follow the Ravens, they're the ones who know. You'll find me at my best somewhere on the West Coast. Send a message just to let you know. I'll tell about the totem silhouetted to the sky, all along the coastline, all the way to Haida Gwaii. And the sound of desolation that's everywhere around, in the far off inlets of desolation sound, where tide water touches the whispering sands. On a clear day you might see all the way to Japan. Just close your eyes and look to the west. Are the gray whales traveling yet? Let the Narrows lead the way. Follow the Ravens, they're the ones who know. You'll find me at my best somewhere on the West Coast. Follow the Ravens, they're the ones who know. You'll find me at my best. If you are looking for the kind of bulls that'll make you smile when their calves arrive,
Be sure and be at Belvin Angus Farm's 10th Annual Bull Sale at the farm south of Innisfail, Alberta, March the 1st. 100 yearlings and long yearling bulls and 10 open heifers sired by these great bulls, known for outstanding EPDs. The sale starts at 1:30, and get this, a complimentary prime rib dinner before the sale. And you can bid online at dlms.ca and see belvinangus.com.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
At Irvine Tack and Western Wear, they'd love to deliver everything to their customers on horseback, because after all, riding is their passion. Of course, that's not really possible, but I'll tell you what, you can order anything online and they'll deliver to your door in no time, by truck, that is. So wrangle up your Western Wear and more at urbans.ca and get this, free shipping on orders over $100. Some restrictions apply, or stop in today the good old-fashioned way. Exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield. Canada's largest Western store. Winter riding. On a working ranch on the northern range, the horses are saddled and ridden pretty much on a daily basis, regardless of the weather. For a lot of recreational riders, though, their horses have most of the winter off, and that can make it harder to get them going in the spring. Working ranch horses are usually shod, especially for winter. Matt Johnson makes our winter shoes with small borium cleats welded to the face of the shoe, and then he puts pads underneath them to pop the snow out and keep it from balling up, and they are amazing, even on glare ice. More than once I've been in the saddle, sorting out a reluctant cow, and the cow will try to escape a couple of times, and next thing you know, she'll have her chin on the ground, her legs spread out after trying to escape, and Cody and I will be standing over her saying, "Make our day, buttercup." Besides the winter shoes, I like to either use a bozal or make sure that the bit is warmed up before I put the bridle on. I find it easier to keep the bridles we use in the winter inside where the bit can be warm all the time. Isn't it dangerous to let a horse sweat in winter? I don't think so. With a heavy hair coat and a couple of hours' work, sweating is inevitable. But I do make sure the horses are cooled down and partially dry before I turn them out after a day of working in the extreme cold. And how about blanketing them? Most of the time, I'd like nature to look after that. The winter coat will grow better if they're not blanketed, and our horses do just fine out in pasture on good quality hay, even at 35 below. Now, if I'm hauling them a long ways, in our stock trailer, though, that's different, and I will blanket them if it's really cold. The wind chill in a trailer can be pretty severe at 60 miles an hour. Most of the time, though, winter riding is a good thing. And I know our horses enjoy it as much as we do. And something else they enjoy is that daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. Find out what's in it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. Well, Leanne Dynesson is on the line, and Leanne, I understand that you had quite a few opportunities to ride with the great Ray Hunt.
Yeah, that was incredible. Ray Hunt, he started coming to Douglas Lake, and then it was through my dad that he went to the gang. Because Ray just, he thought really highly of my dad and vice versa. That was one of my dad's idols he always looked up to. And when Ray was up here for his clinics, he always got Dad to shoe a bunch of his horses and that, because that was my daddy-o's other claim to fame was he was one heck of a farrier.
Wow.
And, yeah, so we'd get that done, and it was really cool to get to meet Ray Hunt and Caroline and just get to hear him and see him do what he did, and it was, yeah, truly incredible.
Were you able to take away a lot of that wisdom and then put it to use?
I tried my best, definitely. It was great to get to go on the colt starting clinic and then also the horsemanship part of it, and still trying, but as all the good horse trainers in that say, you're always learning, you never know everything, and if you think you do, then you're a lost cause already.
Isn't that for sure?
Yeah. You just won't ever know. And I try to, and I remember all the stories about Dad at all the clinics he went to and different colts and stuff he rode. And, it was really great.
Have you started a number of colts yourself, too, over the years?
I did when I was younger. I was all about riding colts and riding the rank ones and that, but that wore off for me. I broke my back a couple times, and lucky to be walking and that to this day. So now I try my best to stay away from colts and that.
Well, I would like to have you come back as soon as you can and tell us the story of maybe how those wrecks happened and how you broke your back and what happened surrounding that. Still to come, our classic Song of the West, sung by a former member of the Sons of the Pioneers and a star of several Western movies, but written by a Canadian radio personality. And the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. This week's classic Song of the West is going to be sung by Wesley Tuttle, a former member of the Sons of the Pioneers, and he had a great solo career as well as appearing in a bunch of Western movies. But the song was written by a guy who was a Calgary policeman, forest ranger, trapper, and a very popular radio DJ on CFAC, Hod Ferris. And recorded in 1952, it's The Call of the Mountain.
I found my love in a mountain by the light of the mountain moon, where the breezes play and the tall pines sway and the birds sing a happy tune. I held her hand in the moonlight and I asked her to be my bride. All nature sang this song to me when she promised to be mine. I love you. I heard the little bird cry. I adore you. The wind in the tree did sigh, I want to hold you. Said the mountains gray and high, then hand in hand by the preacher man, she became my loving bride. Now we've been married for many a year, we've traveled far and wide, from country towns to city squares, up and down the countryside. My wife and me and baby makes three, we're as happy as we can be. Then every night when the sun goes down, I hear her call to me.
I love you.
Preacher man, she became my loving bride. When we grow old and our hair turns gray, I know just what we'll do. We'll pack our grips and head right back and make our dreams come true. We'll sit on the porch of the cabin door when the sun sinks in the blue. When the moon comes up and the night birds call, we'll listen to this tune.
I love you.
I heard the little bird cry.
I adore you.
The wind in the tree did sigh.
I want to hold you.
Said the mountains gray and high, then hand in hand by the preacher man, she became my loving bride.
The late cowboy poet Jess Howard was a saddle bronc rider, and he won the NCRA Saddle Bronc Championship in 1970. And he turned to cowboy poetry in the 90s, writing about his experience and sometimes the ridiculous side of life. And sadly, he passed away in February 2016. This is his original called Cowboy Banker.
I want to be a cowboy, said Banker Larry Brown, and live out in the country instead of cooped up here in town. When his wife got wind of this idea, she almost went berserk, because he made $100,000 a year doing banker work. You don't know how to ride. Heck, you can barely drive a Jeep. This whole idea is dumber than 100 head of sheep. Well, Benny said he'd teach me everything I need to know. That couldn't take too long. There's only giddy up and woe. So he went thumbing through a catalog of Western wear and feed, his calculator humming, adding up the things he'd need. $1,000 for a saddle? There must be some mistake. A saddle surely couldn't cost $1,000, for heaven's sake. A hat and boots, a leather vest, and naturally a rope, braided headstall, matching reins, a bar of saddle soap, a pickup and a trailer and assorted odds and ends, clippers, combs, and brushes for a man's four-legged friend. Saddle blankets, silver spurs, a pair of handmade chinks, and when he hit the total button, it took him half an hour to blink. So he scrapped the cowboy notion as he said with some dismay, I can't afford to be a cowboy on this lousy banker pay.
Well, thanks again for riding along, and I sure hope you can be right back here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to Mark and Kathy McMillan, the Spirit of the West support crew. And be sure and check the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine for the real flavor of the West. And be sure to check out our YouTube channel, where you can see this program and all our past ones with video. And you can download it as a podcast and take it with you. The link's right there on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.